Good afternoon, children. We are going to start with the chapter Microorganism, Friends or Foes today. As you know, the term microorganisms means the living organisms which are invisible to the naked eye, but they are visible under the microscope. They are the microorganisms, and the study is called as microbiology. Now, when we talk about the chapter microorganism friends or foes, it was very important to know about one person who's called as Anton von Leeuwenhoek, because this is the person who is basically associated with the invention of microscope. And only after the microscope was discovered, the people could see the different microorganisms, and we could make out whether they are friends in a way that in what way they are useful to us, or foes in what ways they can be harmful to the human beings or the other life forms. Now, when we have to talk about the different types of microorganisms, they are broadly categorized into four categories: bacteria, fungi, protozoans and algae. Cephalococcus and Vibrio cholerae is an example of bacteria. Bread mold and yeast is an example of fungi. Paramecium and amoeba is an example of a protozoan. Chlorella and Spirogyra is an example of algae. Now, when we have to talk about one different kind of organisms that you are reading and hearing a lot nowadays, that is virus. Now, when we are talking about viruses, we always say they are unique. They are unique, they are different, because they act as a borderline between living and non-living. If they are present outside a host, the host can be a plant, animal, or it can be human beings. They act as if non-living objects, just like salts and sugar crystals present in jars for years and nothing is happening. But the moment they enter the host body, they become active, they start reproducing, and they can cause a lot of diseases in humans. Now, the second topic that we have to talk about is habitat of microorganism. Means, where do they live? They live practically in all the places that you can expect on earth: mountains, rivers, seabeds, oceans, plains, plateaus, deserts, extreme hot, extreme cold, and even the environment which is high in salts. If you are amazed, you would always see a lot of microorganism present even in the human bodies, including the scalp, fingers, everywhere. Now, when we have to talk about the first part of the chapter, microorganism as our friends, they basically have many functions. One, in food, in sewage treatment, in human health, in agriculture, in fuel, in biological nitrogen fixation, and cleaning the environment. Now, when we talk about uses in food, microorganism first is used in curd and cheese formation. For making curd in our homes, we use a bacteria called as lactobacillus. They are used in fermentation process in bakery, making idlis, dosas, breads, pastries, biscuits. They are also used in alcoholic beverages, making alcoholic beverages and vinegar industries. So these are the uses in food. When we talk about the second use, that is sewage treatment, the treatment of industrials and domestic waste, they are called as effluents, and the process of treating them is called as bioaugmentation. I repeat, sewage treatment, all the materials coming from factories and domestic fluids are called as effluent, and their process of cleaning is called as bioaugmentation. Microorganisms also play a role in human health. They help in bowel movement of food in the intestines of the human and the animals. They are also used in making antibiotics. What is antibiotics? They are chemicals that stop the growth of other microorganisms, and they also provide immunity to the human body by generating antibodies. Now, for building the immunity, you must have seen that children in homes are given vaccines. They are suspension of killed or weakened organisms or its derivatives, and these vaccines, when given to the children, creates a memory bank, and this memory bank builds up the antibodies, and they can be used anytime later in the life of the human. Next, in agriculture, microorganism acts in biological nitrogen fixation, and the bacteria which is involved is cyanobacteria. They are also used as fuel and they are also used in the cleaning of the environment. The next that we have to talk about is microorganism as the foes or the enemies. Now there are many microorganisms which can cause diseases in human, plants, animals, etc. And they are called as pathogens. Now when we talk about microorganisms, there are certain diseases which are caused by them and they are called as communicable diseases. Communicable diseases can be spread through air, water, food, physical contact and insects. Air, example, common flu, swine flu, water, typhoid, physical contact, AIDS, insects, rabies. Different microorganisms can also cause diseases. For example, bacteria can cause cholera, tetanus, viruses, influenza, mumps, polio. Fungi can cause ringworm, athlete's foot. Protozoans can cause malaria and amoebic dysentery. Now, we are going to talk about the prevention of different diseases. It's always said that prevention is better than cure. So, there are certain prevention techniques that can be followed for different diseases. For example, when we talk about vaccination, it can be done for the diseases like tuberculosis, polio, mumps and tetanus. If we are using mosquito nets or mosquito repellents, it is effective in diseases like malaria, dengue, chikungunya. Third, if we are going to dispose properly the waste water, it can protect us from cholera, jaundice, and it also can protect us from typhoid. And if we are going to maintain a good personal hygiene, cleaning our hands properly, feet properly, it can help us prevention from the two fungal diseases, that is ringworm and athlete's foot. It's not only that microorganism causes diseases only in human beings. They can cause diseases in plants. They can also cause diseases in animals. If we talk about plants, there are many forms of diseases caused by viruses. One of them is TMV, which is called as tobacco mosaic virus, in which uneven spots and discoloration of leaves occur in tobacco plant. As the name suggests, tobacco, so it is a tobacco disease in which there are uneven spots and discoloration of leaves. Bacteria can cause citrus canker, that is lesions on leaves. As the name suggests, citrus, that means the citrus fruits like lemon, orange, etc. Fungus can cause three diseases. It can cause rust of wheat and wheat, where are orange patches on leaves, smut of rice when there are green patches on the leaves of rice, and red rot of sugarcane that you all must have noticed while eating sugarcane, a red color line which comes as a vertical line between the two internodes of a sugarcane. It is caused by a fungus and it is called as red rot of sugarcane. The next topic that we have to do is food poisoning. So all of you must have heard about the term food poisoning, particularly in the summer and rainy months. What is food poisoning? They are disease that results from the consumption of contaminated food. When the food gets contaminated with microorganisms, it can cause a disease which is called as food poisoning. What are the symptoms that can tell you that a person is food poisoned? He or she can have vomiting, nausea, severe pain in abdominal region. They can have diarrhea. They also can have dehydration. Now, what are the different bacteria or fungi which are present which can cause food poisoning? There are two bacteria known called as Clostridium and Staphylococci which can cause food poisoning. And there is one fungus, Aspergillus, which is also reported to cause food poisoning in human beings. Last topic that we have to talk about is preservation means treating and handling of food to stop or greatly slow down the spoilage. Now, what is the spoilage of food? Loss of quality of food, edibility, that means the by how we can eat them for a longer time, or their nutritive value. Even if the nutritive value of the food is lost, it is also not considered to be food preserved. There are various methods which are being used, tried and tested through generations for food preservation. For example, drying. You must have seen your mothers or grandparents drying cereals, nuts, seeds, etc. Drying reduces the water content from the food. So many fruits apples, pears, bananas, they are dried and they are used later. It reduces the water content and the microorganisms cannot grow in that food. Sugar and salt. You must have seen pickles being formed in your home of different vegetables, jams and jellies being formed. So the pickles which are made in summers can be used like for 2 to 3 years. The jams and jellies can be used. The food can be preserved for longer time. Third is acetic acid, vinegar, citric acid, phosphoric acid. Vinegar can be used for storing a lot of vegetables. Citric acid and phosphoric acid is used in the beverages that we drink, in the cold drinks, etc. The fourth method is heat and cold treatment. As the name suggests, the food can be heated or it can be cold pressed to maintain it for longer time. Fifth, vacuum packing. Chips, biscuits, lot of things which comes in vacuum packing nowadays. Vacuum packing also reduces the spoilage of food from microorganisms. Canning, you must have seen the cans of jams, jellies, olives. You know, they are packed in cans so that the food is not being spoiled by the different microorganism. And the last method of food preservation is freezing. As the name suggests, freezing means storing the food under very low temperatures. A lot of meats, fruits, dry fruits, they can be stored for a longer time by freezing them in lower temperatures. Thank you. That's all for the chapter. We'll continue with the next chapter tomorrow. Cool. Students, in case of any queries, you can post your comments or can WhatsApp me personally so that we can get back to it.